Hello and welcome to our second webinar in the field of veterinary medicine at Cyprus Medical in ISNI. My name is Mareike Zimmermann and I am a member and responsible for sales and support at Cyprus. Nice to have you with us. Today we are talking about the shift of the center of pressure and dynamic stabilization in stance and gait analysis for dogs. If you have any questions or comments during the webinar, please feel free to use the function questions and answers. The speakers will answer these after the presentation. At the end of the webinar, we have a short survey. We would be happy if you could answer these few questions. Now, I have the honor to hand over the floor to Dr. Alexandra Keller and Dr. Kirsten Häusler. Kirsten Häusler runs an animal rehabilitation facility in Stuttgart and helps sick dogs and animals to get back on their feet without medication, but with lots of exercise, expertise, human attention, and patience. Besides, she is engaged in various fields of research and postgraduate education. Dr. Alexandra Keller is specialized in animal chiropractic and owner of the practice Tierärztliches Orthopädie Team in Frankfurt, which is highly specialized on animal orthopedic, sports medicine and rehabilitation. Besides her curative activity, she is engaged in various fields of research and postgraduate education. The stage is yours.
Thank you. So as we talk today about the CanidGait, we have to start first with a movie. And I'm not sure if it works. Does it work? Yes, it works. So if you think about life quality in a dog, you think about maybe about a running dog, playing dog. And if you see this motion in the dog, it is a perfect combination out of muscles, bones, and power. And to know how that works or to think about the health of this body, it is really important to know a lot of things. Nearly 10 years ago, there's a new publication. I think it should be a standard work for an orthopedic working veterinarian or physiotherapist. It was a complete study from Professor Fischer and Karin Lilje, and it was published in 2011. They examined 327 dogs on a treadmill from 32 different breeds, and this book is full of information about muscles, about function, about motion, and it got a lot of information in the walking, in the trotting, in the galloping dog, as well as muscle function, and it is a gold standard I think we have to use in our practice. One really important thing I got out of this book is that in the conclusion, the difference within the breeds are greater than between the different breeds. What does it mean? So for me, it is the personal thing is that you every time has to examine your patient as an individual patient. It is important to check out where are the problems. You have to see effects on the hind limb to the front limb and everything. So it is really important to see every single patient as an individual patient. And for that, in the last years, the small animal orthopedics changed a lot. So years ago, we are more focused on only the skeletal and only on the joints. And over the years, the diagnosis and the therapy changed a lot. And we are much more examining the entire muscle skeleton system, and we treat the entire muscle skeleton system. How does it work? We got, beside our examination, and I think it is still the main important or most important thing that you have got a good gait analysis and a good orthopedic examination. Nothing of this modern diagnostic imaging helps if you do not have a focus on your work and if you don't have a good outcome out of the orthopedic examination. But beside that, we need more. And we have got the modern diagnostic imaging with a technology which is amazing and which changed in the last years so much. We have got the digital X-rays, the direct system. Sometimes we have got the possibility to have this in mobile form so that it is possible to have a dog in standing position. We can use high-end ultrasound for muscle skeleton ultrasound in dogs as well. We can use a CT, and by now we have got the fourth generation with 16 lines. We got really excellent information on a CT scan. And as well, the MRI is with the techniques up to 1.5 Tesla, we got so many informations about muscle, nerves, soft tissue, that it is amazing what we can see in the diagnosis. Only to compare the image, this was an ultrasound of a stifle in a dog 20 years ago, and to be honest, I only see grays and clouds, and I was not really sure what I can see. And if you see the same today, it is much easier to find some structures, as you see the ligamentum patellae over here, if you see the fat pad over here, if you see the cranial crucial ligament over here, it makes it clear that it is possible to examine the smaller structures and you see much more of the soft tissue and the connective tissue. An important point, again, if we think about this running dog in the beginning, is that we need functional diagnostic for a lot of situations. It is not every time that we have got good results in a laying position. It is not the functional position of the spine. It is not the functional position of the hip. So it's really helpful if you can do some X-rays in a standing position, because you can see the functional formation of the joint, you see the functional curve of the spine, and so on. A really good benefit of the ultrasound, and in this image you see the superficial digital ligaments in the toe of a dog, so you can definitely see the different structures. And you also can do dynamic examinations where you see the motion of these ligaments. I hope you can see that at your screen at home. So beside all this nice technique we can use, still, as I said before, the orthopedic examination and before, the gait analysis is one of the most important part of the orthopedics in small animals. Also, if you see sport dogs, also if you see geriatric dogs or young dogs, every time you have to start with this, with a gait. So in dogs, it could be a little bit a challenge. So sometimes you see a nice gait like in this little whippet. You can examine the motion of the hind legs. You can examine the movement. This dog is really well behaved. He walked next to the owner, and you can examine. And on the other side, sometimes you have a dog like this, which is not really used to the leash, and where you are not really sure, is it really a lameness examination or not? So that could be a challenge, but it is so important. So maybe we have got a chance to use a gait on a treadmill. So it is much more constant. You can have your eyes on the leg, you can fix one position, and you can decide which joint maybe is more flexed or which not. But all these together is a subjective, individual gait analysis. It is really hard. Sometimes you have got with the new technologies like a smartphone, you have got the possibility to do little movies, but it is still a subjective analysis. And for that, I was so happy that we have got now the digital stance and gait analysis with a treadmill, because this is an easy way to use it in the daily practice. It is not like we have it with the force plates where you have to need a complete lab where you need three people to analyze the data. So this is a treadmill where you can measure the gait and where you get a lot of information. The treadmill has got a size of 2 meters, so it is usable for big dogs as well. So in our practice, sometimes we have got Great Danes walking on the treadmill and it works. You can use it from around 5 kilogram to 80 kilogram, and the speed is going up to 20 kilometers per hour. So it is a nice tool to examine the gait, and as you see here, you can have a measurement of 200 hertz. That is a really good power, and it is a good possibility to examine. So first of all, the stance analysis. In our practice, we use the stance analysis now nearly 10 years. Before we had the possibility with the CanidGait, we used the stance analyzer. And you know that you have got a weight distribution in dogs with 60% in the fore limbs and 40% in the hind limbs. And if you do the measurements, and if you do the measurements every time in the same dogs, if you compare the dogs in between, you see changes, and you can decide, and you see an improvement of therapy, and sometimes you can decide or use it as a tool for your diagnostics. In the CanidGait, it is the same way. You have to stand the dog on the treadmill, and you can do a measurement over time, and finally you got some objective digital information about the force distribution. It is in percentage of the body weight. So nearly our 60% in the forelimb and 40% in the hind limb. As you see here, this example has lesser weight on the right hind leg. And these are informations you can get. On the other side, you see from the point or from the center of pressure or from the center of gravity in this example, you see sometimes changes where you shift the weight to one or to the other side. And these are informations you also can give to the owner. And he's really happy because if you as a veterinarian or physiotherapist, you can examine. And I'm sure your eyes can see sometimes if the dog gives lower pressure or force on one leg, but it is not really clear sometimes for the owner. This is a report you can print, you can give it to the owner, you can use it as a therapy control after a time, and you see improvement, or sometimes you see if it is not an improvement, so if it got worse, you have to change something in the therapy. Besides the stance analysis, it's a huge benefit to have with the CanidGait, the digital gait analysis. And as you see here, you can add cameras up to 4. You have got different positions. You can examine the gait. You can use slow motion. You can do it faster. You can make a break, and you can stop. You can measure angles. And on the left side, you see the toes, how they roll over, how they bring the pressure on it. And it is an excellent way to get an objective way for the gait analysis. Beside this visual information, you got more. You got the force distribution, the same way we had before in the stance analysis. In a trotting or in a walking dog, it is different, but you can compare, of course, left and right. You can see how the center of pressure is located in the dog, and you see much more in the next picture, because here you have the center of pressure, and you see as well if the weight is shifted to one side or to the other side. These are the toes. You got more information about how is the toe positioned on the ground. You see the size of the toe. Here you see differences on the right side, 62, and on the other side, 70 square centimeters. So these give you information about the standing position, about the muscle function, and the good benefit if you use the center of gravity or the center of pressure, you can use it for the rehabilitation, for the effect of a therapy, like a medical therapy, like a chiropractic therapy, like a surgery. You have got this measurement before, you can see the improvement after a time, and you can compare objective digital. You got much, much more information with gait parameters. You got information about straight length, track width, length of gait cycle, stance and swing phase. So you got a lot of detailed information which you can compare. And if you see this information, it is not that you every time have changes in the straight length. Sometimes it's only the force distribution where you see changes. Sometimes it's only the straight length. So this gives you detailed information where the problem in the muscle skeleton system is located. Another good thing is the force curve and the gait patterns. So as you see on the left side here, it is a typical force curve of a walk with a peak in the beginning, then a little decrease, and then a little peak an increase in the end of the if the toe press from the treadmill. And this is typical for a walk. And these are the typical information you got if the dog is trotting. As it is a two-step gait, you see ideal that in the perfect world the dog steps direct in the front leg, so from with the hind leg, so that you have got only this nearly two steps. In a walk, it is different. You can decide if it is changed, if you have got differences in the gait patterns, you got a lot of information in the first visit, and you can see the effect on the rehabilitation. The center of pressure curves gives you information how the symmetry is in the dog, how symmetric the weight was shifted from the left to the right side. These are the hind legs, these are the forelegs, front legs, and this is a center of gravity which is shifted, which is then a two-dimensional measurement, which is then the center of pressure. In a trot, it's a little bit different, and you see the red one is faster. It's, of course, much, much faster. So this was a little short introduction, and today we want to talk about the effects on the center of pressure, about effects of incline and decline walking, and I give to my colleague, Kirsten.
Well, thank you, Alexandra. And I hope you can see my presentation. Thanks for coming up to our webinar today. It's the second webinar, and we want to dive into the gait analysis a little bit deeper. So Alex gave a great information about how to approach gait analysis. So what we're looking at now is a particular case where we see a lot of changes. A lot of changes have been made in the dog. I will show you one of the changes, which is a huge biomechanical change, and we will try to follow this up. So we will focus a little bit on the center of pressure, which is quite important if you want to follow up the case and if you want to see if your results are the way you want them to be from therapy or any medication or from a pain perspective. So we do look at different things. So we look at what happens on even ground. We look at what happens on an incline, because you can easily run the dogs on an incline and on a decline. So again, looking at paws, the paws of our patients will tell us a story. So you can see in the image dogs that I took a photograph from underneath. So I just put them on a glass plate, and we took some pictures, and that's pretty impressive. And that's to what we see digitally, where the pressure points. In some cases, you can see this already here. So you have here, there are some pressure points in standing. This would be kind of like a stance analysis live. And then you want to have this to evaluate it objectively. So, as Alex mentioned, it's really important that you look at x-rays and CT, but sometimes you can even use the stance or gait analysis to investigate and dive deeper or know where you might want to take a CT of, and not just kind of like, sometimes it's, we'll look, take a look at this and that. So we might want to change the point of view from beginning at the paw prints, and then we can maybe go up further and see what we're doing. So this is taken from the book Dogs in Motion again. So what Alex mentioned, there is a lot of information in here, and I won't talk about the active paws or the active muscles, but I just wanted to let you know, take a look at this book and look how and which muscles are activated during which stance phase, and this will lead you to what we have seen before, the average force curves, and then you can take a look and relate to the muscles that are activated and probably be able to draw a conclusion. So in each patient, you will see different things. So you have active muscles superficially, and you have to pay attention to deep muscles as well. So it's a deeper dive into this. We can't cover that, obviously, today. So this is Emmy's case. Emmy is the dog down here. You can see her. She had multiple issues. She has ED on both elbows, and one side was worse. So the surgeon decided to do an SHO, sliding humerus osteotomy. So you can see the x-rays within. The dog was, in this case, referred to me for gait analysis. So somebody else is doing the therapy, and we're working together to find out how to help the dog. So it's not only that you have it in your practice, it's kind of like a, maybe like a CT scan. Not everybody's able to own one, but you can refer back and forth. So this is a huge advantage, I'd say. And this is what Emmy's gait looked like. And again, you can see she's walking. She's on a loose lead here. We have different views, and you can see she also had a cruciate ligament rupture on her left hind leg. So this is a dog with multiple issues. We're not only dealing with one, so we have to approach this case kind of differently. So what can we see? I often tend not to only look at them while they're walking on uneven ground, because in real life you have to go up and downhill. And owners will tell you there is a problem when they have to go upwards, or if they have to trot somewhere and there's an incline, there will be an issue, or going downwards could be an issue. So we look at the dog on the same day. We will look, this is on leveled ground. So this is a 3 kilometer walking. And then we see changes once we have the dog walking on an incline. This is an incline in 10%. So those are indicators we will bear in mind and compare. And we want to see if the dog not only improves on leveled ground, or if there's anything we can look and have to look for, as you can see with the pressure distribution through the paws here, and a little bit of a shift going upwards to the hind paws. It is also interesting in terms of surgeries, where is or where are the pressure points? So if you do an osteotomy, you want to know where to shift and what to shift. This is refers back to the x-rays taken in an physical position and not in a lying position, maybe, so we can compare that. So if you look at those paw prints, we have a shifting, we have changes in the area the paw covers. You can see those pressure points we saw in the picture before. You can see how the center of pressure has a different angle, so it's a bit off. So we have an unloading onto the front right and an offloading from the front left. We do see a little bit of a change back here in that cruciate ligament leg, especially if we go on an incline. So we see changes in the area covered on both. So again, just for you to be highlighted that we always look at all four paws. And then we look at our average force curves. And if you look at those curves, you can see differences which occur during placing the paw to the ground. So what we see in the front left is that we don't have this incline that we would like to have. So putting down the paw is not as forceful as we would like it to be. And then we can see that the other side compensates. So you have a slight incline and then you have a drop. And it's even worse when you go uphill. And then this leg has to compensate in pushing forward more for the other side, which isn't as good as that side. And then you can see changes in the back again. So, and you have to look at this individually. There is no, this has to be this way, because as you can see with a dog having multiple surgeries, you will not be able to refer to this dog will look like this. So again, taking a look at all of those components might be challenging when you take a first look, but once you get used to looking and comparing those, you know what to look for. And the owner will be really happy and much more motivated, even through phases where you have to say, well, we're doing a change to the body, we're changing, we're in training, muscles have been built up, it's more mobile, it will take some time, and they will be and stay engaged because it's easier for them to understand what we're doing and we can show it now. So again, this is just for you to think about paw placing again. And looking at the dog from the top, I think, is a lot of times really a good thing, because you can see, well, what happens to the spine as well. And having a chiropractor, having a team approach to a dog like this will end up in better results for the dog. So again, those paw prints, we've seen this before, and this is like a follow-up. So we start in April, then we go to June. This is down here, and you can see there have been some changes, but she came back. The other physiotherapist, we talked about this case because the improvements weren't the way we thought they would work out, and then we discussed how to change the therapy, and now we're at this point where we do still have lane meniscus, but we but you can see that the distribution through the paws here doesn't look that bad. Once we go into an incline again, we see there are changes again, but on even ground we are okay with what we're seeing right now, because the dog obviously is still limping. Not obviously in the pressure points here, but when you see the video, which we always look at, you can see those changes and that it's still a problem. And the owner will tell you, and we will look at those images, and then we can see the other changes. What Alex also mentioned is looking at gait patterns. So you can think of this being the treadmill just turned to the side, and you just multiply all the gait cycles, put them together, and so each of the dogs has their own gait pattern. And what we're looking for is a symmetry. We want to be more symmetric. So sometimes if they have a step width, there's an issue. If they kind of like step to the side, which would be down here, that's where you have like the impression, or not just the impression, but you can see the dog is kind of like waving like this. So looking at those gait patterns and looking at them in a follow-up, you will see this is the second visit and this is the third visit. So we do see a lot of improvement in step width. So she's getting to the point where she is more symmetric. She will never be symmetrically, and none of us are, but that's the goal we want to achieve, and that's what we're looking for. In terms of COP and the density, so this is the density of all measurements we made, or all of the gait cycles within. So we see the density where the paw prints, where most of the pressure lies in this dog. Those are the front legs again. In comparison, this is the center of pressure of the whole body, and this is the center of pressure of each of the paws, front and back. And what we want to achieve is kind of like a lying eight. Sometimes we do achieve, sometimes we don't, and we can see there is still lameness here. So this is again a follow-up, and we will compare. So this is the first visit and the second visit, so we can always put two of those reports next to each other, and then we see the second visit and the third, and we can see it's much smoother now. So, and if you have a smoother line for the center of pressure, then you won't be as, you won't need as much energy to have a good gait, which increases their ability to move around, and they won't need that much. So again, what I put next to it is the gait pattern, so you can understand how those changes and how those shifts and angles in the center of pressure will show up in the gait pattern. And this is something you have to dig in, you have to look at that multiple times, but putting the gait parameters together with those pictures is crucial. And this is the point, this is like the second one and the third one compared again. So, just again, I like those gait patterns. And this is what I wanted to show you, to dive into looking at and comparing gait patterns and parameters to the center of pressure. So I will hand over to Alex again, because she has another case for you.
So after we saw with Kirsten a nice case and the improvement of a case after surgery, I want to show you a case which is a long case, a long time case, but which is without any surgery, and it is a young dog. So maybe you can see the influence of a good training in young dogs and changes for the, yeah, for the life and maybe for the quality of life. So this is Brand's case. It is a border collie. When he was presented in our practice, he was young, he was 10 months old, and he should start a sports career in agility and obedience, but he came over with a lameness in the hind limb after a trauma. And during examination and during digital imaging, it was not a problem from, for example, the tussle or the stifle. The main problem was in the adductor muscles in the hip. And the reason for that was that also with 10 months old, so this was this early examination in the dog, you see that the hip x-ray is not really perfect. You have got not a good shape of the trochanter, and you do not have a good shape of the acetabulum. And also in the examination, the Ortolani test was positive, so you were sure that there is a main problem in the hip joint. So the owner is really nice and handsome with the dog, and as she wants to go to agility, she said, okay, then I change and do the work for my dog, for his quality of life. And she started an amazing program for this dog, and after 8 months they do the official hip imaging, and you see after this 8 months which changes you can see in the femoral joint, in the coxofemoral joint, and you have got a traumatic osteoarthritis in the joints already. But if you examine the dog, it is not that this dog is really painful. It is not that this dog has got so many changes in the gait. And the reason for that is that the dog is an amazing training partner. And the owner starts an intensive professional physiotherapy. She starts with 1 to 2 times a week with the training. And this training is not only based in an underwater treadmill, for example. They do a lot of position training, different muscle training, and he is really nice and handsome, and he loves to do some jobs. So our physiotherapist loves this patient, and I think in your practice as well, these are the dogs you really love. You can think about, okay, which training we should do, and the dog is doing that. And the owner is training at home. The owner is doing a lot of homework together with a professional physiotherapist online system. It is really nice with Bobby Lyons. And she's doing an amazing job. And think about muscle work and posture, not only examination, but training, posture training as well. The dog added with nutraceuticals, and after a time, because of this coxofemoral arthrosis, of the cox arthritis, we do an injection with Atromed Vet. It's a polyacrylamide, and after that, the motion of the hip getting better, because it is a functional thing that if you have got this cox arthrosis in the joint, that you have got less motion in the joint because of joint capsule and tissue around. And after the injection, it improves a little bit more. So all of these parts are this multimodal, multifactorial treatment. And after the time, and this is a great thing with the gait analysis, you can see improvements of the gait. And you can document the therapy process, and you give that to the owner because they can see changes. And in this example, it is 1 year ago, the left side, and now, it's a really actual measurement. You see that you have got an improvement in the force in the hind legs. That's what you like. You have got a better footstep in the hind leg. You have got, if you examine the dog, you have got much more muscles in the hind leg. And you can see the changes in the force curves as well. So in the left side, we have got this 1 year ago. It is, you see the lower force curves, especially in the hind legs, especially if the dog has to press to remove the leg from the ground. And in the right side, you see that you have got a much more increase in the second peak of the curve. Also, the center of pressure curves changed. That was what Kirst mentioned before. You see on the right side a much more better symmetric, especially in the center of pressure or in the center of gravity. You have got this typical butterfly form. And these are improvements you can hand out to the owner, and the owner is much more motivated if they see that it is that the dog has a benefit of all this time and all this training they invest. These are the center of pressure speed in the toes. So this is good information as well. And you see the changes after a year. And it is especially in the hind leg, you see a much more symmetric gait. This is another possibility we can use. This is especially if you do some sport dogs. Sometimes you have got only if they have got not that good results in the sports, and sometimes you need this stress test. It is not so easy to do it outside that you said, okay, go for 20 minutes running outside and then come back, please. So you often see in your practice the dog standing out of a laying position, jumping out of the car, and then you do the gait analysis. So it's a helpful tool if you can measure the dog on the treadmill, and after, for example, this is a sportive dog, after 20 minutes again. And this was Pran as well. And what you can see is after 20 minutes, it's not that the dog has less weight on the hind leg. The difference is the case. So you have got more weight in the hind legs, and that's what we want. So one reason, or what is the main important thing to work with these dogs, is to do motion and to do gait and to do running and to do a lot of things, and not only rest should be the best for the joints. Also, the force curves changed after 20 minutes a little bit. And the pressure distribution in the trot as well after 20 minutes. This is trot before it was a walk. So in the trot, you see that you have got in the hind legs, you have got a more circle speed or center of pressure speed in the hind legs after the time. So that is a case that you see. Normally, you want to have more this, yeah, from the back to the front force in the toes as well. These are changes we have to work with, and these are changes if you improve a little bit more the hamstrings as well and the function, and again go back to the dogs in motion. If you think about the function, which is not perfect, so you can see this nice function connections from one muscle to the other muscle in different phases, and you can adapt your training for that. So we have all over, this was only two little cases, but all over we have got application areas in the CanidGait we can use in the daily practice, and we can use especially in orthopedic or surgery practices, and of course in physiotherapy. It is an important tool for objective gait analysis and also a presentation of minimal lameness. Sometimes you have got this little changes in the gait, and you could not see it with your eyes. It is only that sometimes the owner said it is only in the morning after the dog was sleeping 8 hours, the first step, then you have got maybe the possibility to got a little movie with a smartphone, but it is complicated. So sometimes you see this little changes in the digital analysis as well. As we saw before, stress test could be a great tool to find different pathologies. And how you do that is the first measurement in stance. You can use it for stance as well, walk and trot. And then you do a 10 to 20 minutes stress. And then the second measurement as well in stance, walk and trot. And then you can compare as we did it before. And this compare should be individual for every dog. You also can use it for flexion test and local anesthesia. We use it a lot, this flexion test and the local anesthesia. It's not a really typical thing what you use in small animals, but it is a perfect way if you have got this treadmill that you have got this objective analysis of the gait. And of course, and we saw that in our two cases before, the therapy process should be one main goal with the CanidGait, because you can decide for this individual patient which is the best therapy. You can change the therapy if you have not an improvement of the gait, and that's an amazing tool. Also, in this case, you do the measurement during the diagnosis. Before you start with the therapy, you do a second measurement, maybe earlier, but sometimes after 4 weeks, after 6 months, after 1 year. So it should be a long-term outcome what you can measure. And sometimes you have got the possibility to differentiate between different lameness types. Sometimes you have got arthrosis in the toe, and you have got a biceps tendon problem as well. If you see changes in the gait, you can decide if it is more a muscle problem or if it is more the toe problem. And at this point, we want to mention, of course, our nice project, which we start together with Professor Fischer in Jena and with Julia Schibilla in the north of Germany, and Kiki and I. And Katja Sönl, of course, she's the main part in Jena, because she's putting all the stuff together. And our main goal is to see how the changes of this gait from a puppy to an adult dog. The main tool is the treadmill. So we start with the young dogs on the treadmill. We start most of the times with 8 weeks and up to 3 years, and we follow up this gait. Here in this case, Kiki can tell a little bit more about that.
So this was one of the pilot cases we used to form this form of study, because we were looking at a puppy with 9 weeks and then looking at it 2 weeks later. And there's a lot of things that change in puppies in the first year of their growth. And as our focus is sometimes we look at certain indications. At this point, we want to look at how they develop, how they cope, maybe cope with some of the things that occur in some of the breeds that we will look at. And the other side, what Alex mentioned, is seeing a dog with a hip dysplasia, looking at the x-ray, we are not the x-ray. Not us, not the dogs. So what surrounds the bones plays a great role. And if we can look at it functionally, we will not always disappoint our owners, as in that case with Bran. So there's a lot to surround the muscles, and you will look at your x-rays because you will have a follow-up in the x-rays as well. But you can say, but my dog is coping well with it. And that should be the point that we're looking for to improve their quality of life. So I think we're done.
And with this study, we want to ask you, if you have got your own young dog, maybe, for example, or if you know a young puppy which maybe could attend, or if you're interested in results, or if you're interested what we are doing exactly, you can check out this internet page, web page, and you find a lot of more informations, detailed informations.
Unfortunately, it's only to people in Germany, open to people in Germany.
They can travel?
They can travel, yes.
They can travel
every 4 weeks
to Germany?
You can come and join us.
Yes. So I want to I want to finish with this dog. So you remember in the beginning this nice running dog. This is the same dog. And if you see how the dog in this laying position is, every time you have to think about this running dog, the dog in motion, this is quality of life, and it is so important to add this tool of gait analysis to your daily treatment, because it gives a much better possibility to find a good diagnosis and to find a good therapy. So now we are really done, and we are happy about some questions, if you have got questions. I don't see any questions. So, hopefully next time you're coming back, I'm sure we find other themes what we want to talk about. We are focused maybe on neurology or other things, and show up some different cases, and hope you will be attend again.
Yes. So I think we have a lot in mind that we can show. So thanks for having us, and yeah.
So well, if there are no questions, a big thank you to all of you and to the two speakers for this nice presentation. So thanks, Frau Dr. Häusler and Dr. Keller, for this interesting and informative and entertaining webinar at Zebris here in ISNI. Also, many thanks to you and to as participants and contributing behind the scenes. So, one last question. We prepared a short survey for you with a few questions. We would appreciate if you could take a few moments to answer these now. This will help us to improve all further webinars. So, yeah, a lot of thanks and goodbye.